Well, good morning.
That was a little loud.
It is a great morning, and I am so glad that each and every one of you could be here today, whether you are a member of the past 20, 25 years that we've seen every week, or whether this is your first time in the building. We are so glad that you could join us here on this Resurrection Sunday, as Mark hit a home run with his communion today, and he doesn't know this, but now I'm kind of floundering around because I don't know what I'm going to say. He stole my outline, I think, and read it word for word. But no, it is such a great story that it bears repeating. It's a story that we as humans have been embraced by. We've been attracted to this story because it is more than a story. It is our hope. And it is missing a power button, maybe. Still works. Okay. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. I'm up here today, and Doug will be up here today as well. We're kind of tag teaming this sermon. But we're here to share that story once again. That story that, as I'm about to talk about, is kind of a dark story. We read the story of the crucifixion, and you look at it on the surface. This is a story about a man being tortured and killed. And as you read this story, there's some light that shines through. And not just some light, but it's a bright light that shines through in this dark story. And so it's no wonder that we are so attracted to it. Because although this is a story about death, it's more than that. It's a story about life. And so I want to take us back, all the way back to the beginning. And we have 10 minutes apiece to share this ginormous story with so many different details in it. But I'm going to take some time, and I want to go all the way back to the beginning when God made everything, and it was good. It was not only good, it was great, it was perfect. And God made it all, and then we came along and messed everything up. And I teach the youth group, and they like to say, how hard would it have been for Adam and Eve to just not eat of that one tree, right? I mean, it's just one tree. You got all these other trees. We eat of that tree every day. Today, we eat of that tree. We go against what God has told us, and we continually sin. Although we know God doesn't want us to, we do it. And because of sin, there must be some sort of payment. And because of sin, death has entered this world. And so in the old covenant, that death in the form of animal sacrifices was the payment. But God knew that payment was not enough. The blood of bulls and goats was not enough to cleanse humanity of this dark stain upon our souls. And so God had a plan from way back in the beginning, way back when he made everything and it was good. God had a plan because he knew we were going to need salvation. And so Jesus came. God came. Our Creator, our King, our God came down in the form of Jesus. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. God knew that a greater sacrifice was required, and so he came in the form of Jesus with a job to do, a price to pay, and he paid it. There on that cross, Jesus paid that price. He gave his life as the one true sacrifice required to bring salvation to all men. And with that act, Jesus' mission was completed. And we get this great line in John 19, verse 30. It is finished. And I picture Jesus hanging on that cross, dying, grasping for his last breath. And for him to speak at all is amazing, the effort it took for him to speak. And so I just picture him up there, just barely getting these words out. It is finished. And then he gives up his spirit. But today, I say those words. I say it with joy. I say it loudly. And I proclaim, I say, praise God. It is finished. Because God paid that price. He bore it all so that we may have salvation.
My precious Savior suffered. He bore it all that I might live. Jesus bore it all. See his shining face. He bore it all that I might live. Stood condemned to die. Freely took my place. He bore it all. He bore it all that I might live. The cruel man with spear, his side was pierced and bled. He bore it all that I might live. Jesus bore it all. See his shining face. He bore it. Stood condemned to die, freely took my place. He bore it all that I might live.
See, that's an amazing story, isn't it? He bore it all. He took the price that I owed. I owed my life. But I couldn't pay it because my life is tarnished. Jesus lived a perfect life and gave his life in place of mine, in place of yours, so that we could be free from the sin that tears us away from the promise of God, and we could be free to enjoy the promise he gave us, life with him forever. So he said on the cross, it's finished. I did what you sent me to do. I gave my life. And he paid the price for our sin. But as Mark said this morning, the story doesn't end there. Because if it was just another man who died, it doesn't mean anything. It was God who died on the cross. And just 3 days later, he proved that. He proved that death has no power over God. And therefore, has no power over us. Look at what he said. It was the next day, the one after preparation day. The chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I'll rise again.' So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he's been raised from the dead. And this last deception will be worse than the first." "So take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go, make the tomb as secure as possible." So they went and they made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. After the Sabbath, at the dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. I love that phrase. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said." This portion of Scripture, this portion of God's plan, was so important. This identifies the man who died. This was not somebody who just gave his life for a cause. There are a lot of liberal theologians today who deny the resurrection. People who wear the name of Christ, even, who deny the resurrection, saying things like that don't happen. But the fact that the Sanhedrin, the Jews, they came before the governor, Pilate, and they said, "Listen, he devised a plan. He told this crazy story before he died that he would raise in 3 days. So let's make sure that nobody carries out this hoax. Let's make sure that nobody's duped by these disciples coming and stealing his body away." And they posted a Roman guard. The Roman guard was under threat of their life. If somebody came and took the body, they would pay with the price of their life. And God sent an angel. And there's a great earthquake. And he rolled the stone away and sat on it. Can't you just see the picture? He rolls the stone away and he sits on it like, "So what are you going to do now, Satan? Come on, give me your worst." And the guards stood there like dead men. Didn't say they passed out. Didn't say they fainted. They just couldn't move. They were so paralyzed with fear. Here's an angel who looks like lightning sitting on the stone. And then the Marys come and they look for him. They said, "Listen, this was no ordinary man. You know he wasn't ordinary. You watched what he did. You watched his whole life. You watched how he loved people, even his enemies. You watched the miracles that he performed, not for his own sake, but for the good of others. You watched and you heard what he taught, and you know what he did for you and how he changed your lives. You know he was not an ordinary man, and this proves that he is not here. He is risen." Hallelujah. We praise God for his involvement. God did not have to do this for us. A God, we sang that song, he could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world. God, they're not worth it. They don't deserve what we're about to give them. And he was exactly right. We don't deserve it. But he gave himself for us. And he promised us something. The resurrection proved who he was, but the resurrection did something else. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul talks about this resurrection as being the first fruits. In other words, he said, get ready because this is just the first of many. This is our hope as well. God didn't just say, I just forgive your sins. He said, I give you the hope of the resurrection. He told his friend, Mary Martha, he says, I am the resurrection. I am the life. Whoever believes in me will never die. They will continue. The bodies will pass away, but let me show you resurrection. And his body rose from the grave. He is not dead. He is risen and alive today, as is our future. That is the hope for each one of us. We are not made for this world. We are made for something far greater. And God has promised that to us, and he gave us a grand display of what that looks like in the resurrection of Jesus.
His son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior.
Life is worth the living just because he lives. This resurrection is not something we celebrate with a side of deviled eggs and ham. This resurrection, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, Mark, thanks once again, 1 Corinthians 15 is the most important thing. Paul says, for what I received, I pass on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared. And then he goes on to list all of those people that he appeared to, and there are a bunch of them. So it's not just two or three guys that said, look, I saw Jesus. There's a whole group of people that Jesus appeared to after he had died, after he had laid in that tomb, after he had raised. And Paul says that this is the most important thing. The most important thing. And I think we often forget that. We get caught up in all these little things that seem huge, that seem important. But Paul says this is the most important. Are there other things that we have to believe and that we have to do? Of course. Are there some things we don't quite understand about the resurrection? Yes. And the people in Corinth, they struggled with those questions too. They had questions for Paul about the resurrection. But Paul goes on to say, how foolish. Hey, God will give you a body that is imperishable. It will be different from these bodies. The body that is sown is perishable, but it is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. We don't know exactly what that will look like, but we know that we will all be changed in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye, into something that is imperishable, that disease has no power over, that age has no power over, that death has no power over. We will be given a body that is not under the power of sin and death. And when that happens, then the saying will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now let me be clear. It says, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? Death still hurts us. We miss dearly those that have gone, those that have already passed on. We have memories of family members, of parents, children, taken well before their time. We have memories of hospital visits, of graveside services, and those hurt. But as Christians, as followers of Christ, there's a joy along with the sorrow. Because although it stings for now, we know that we have been given the gift that conquers death. And so that although people have passed from this life, and we will pass from this life, that body that is sown will be raised a body of power, a spiritual body that is imperishable. And that is what Paul tells us. The sting of death is sin, the power of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And that is why we celebrate Easter. We go through all this, the fun activities, sideshow stuff, the Easter bunny, the egg hunts, the chocolate, the candy, but that's not why we celebrate Easter. We celebrate it because we know we have victory over death. And hallelujah that we do. Praise God that He has given us this gift, that Jesus was raised from the dead as the first fruit among many to come. That victory is ours, and it has been given to us by our Lord and Savior, Jesus.
Please stand with me.
Old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And some sweet Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Please be seated.
Victory. It's ours because God loved us so much that he sent his one and only Son to die on the cross. Not because we deserved it, but because he chose to love us. And he gives us hope. He gives us that victory over death, that this life is not all there is. There is more that God has promised to us. Granted, this is all that we know. And so we sometimes get caught living this life as if it were the most important thing because it's all that we know. Nobody's gone to heaven and come back and told us, and if they did, we probably wouldn't believe them. It's amazing the miraculous things that people have seen and still refuse to follow God. That there were miraculous things that happened and people refused to accept them and change their lives. The children of Israel walked through the Red Sea. And a couple weeks later, you remember what they were doing? Building a calf to a foreign god. They didn't know how to put their faith in Christ. But there were people all along the road who did know how to put their faith in Christ. And they paved their way for us. They've given us an example to follow. They said, we know that God has more in store than this life. And we have so much more to hope for than just this life. And so we live our life with a vision ahead of us of what God has promised. Hebrews 11 has a great story of those people. Just some of the things that they said about faith and what life looks like lived by faith. He said faith is confidence in what we hope for. It's assurance about what we do not see. And this is what the ancients, people who've gone long time before us, what they were commended for. I am so grateful to be living this side of the cross, aren't you? Because we know how God works things out. He paid the price for our sin. These ancients living back then, they didn't know how God was going to work it out. But they trusted that he would. And so by faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. And then he starts talking about all these people who lived by faith. By faith, Enoch, and he tells the story of Enoch and what he did. By faith, Noah. He tells the story of Noah, how Noah built an ark. He worked for 125 years building an ark to save people through a flood he'd never experienced. By faith, Abraham listened to God and left his home and went to a place, and he lived out in the wilderness in tents, knowing that God had something greater in store. By faith, even Sarah, when Abraham was 100 years old and she was close behind, and God said, "You'll have a son," she believed. They laughed at first, but then they believed. And Isaac came along, and by faith, Isaac became the father of Jacob and Esau. And the story goes on. By faith, there was Jacob, there was Joseph, Moses, Rahab, Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets. And he goes on and on. All these people who gave their lives, all these people who lost loved ones, all these people who said, "I will live because I'm going to trust my God that there's more to this life than I can see." And they give us an example of what it looks like. All the stuff that happens in this life, they're important things. And what we do today is important. It has implications for the future. It has implications for eternity. And all these people who lived by faith, none of them were perfect. Every single one of them were flawed. Even Abraham, the father of the nation, was a man who lived with fear. And it caused him to lie. It caused him to doubt. It caused him to question God's protection. It caused him a lot of things that he shouldn't have given into. And yet, he was a man. He was flawed. And yet, even beyond the flaws, he put faith in God that this life was not all there was, and so he lived in that hope. And this is what we are called to as well, to live in that hope, that this life is not all there is. We don't just work hard and then die. But God gives us victory over death. He's promised us heaven. I don't know what it looks like. I don't know what it's going to be like, except he says some great things. There will be no tears. There's no death. There's no darkness there. Now you say, "Well, I like darkness." He's talking about darkness, about spiritual darkness. There is darkness over this land. We read about some of the evil things that people do to each other. We experience some of the hurt and the hardship that happens to us. And we know there's a darkness over this land. He says in heaven, it's not there. We have a place to live where he shines all the time, to bask in the glory of his presence. And my guess is it's not going to be boring. Some people have said, "Well, Doug, if we just sit there and strum harps all day, yeah, just kill me now." It's not going to be like that. He's got stuff for us to do, good stuff. I don't know what it is, but my hope is in him. He has proven himself faithful. He has loved us so much that he sent his son who died and paid the price for our sin. He rose from the grave, showing us what we can expect to receive from him, resurrection. And so we rejoice in that presence. Rejoice in what God has done for us. And so we're going to sing a song that says, "God, thank you for all that you've done. Thank you, thank you, thank you." Because he's promised us things we never deserved. And he says, "I want you to have these things, but you have to accept it. I offer you a gift, but you have to say yes to it. You have to say, I accept your gift," and what it means, Paul explained it so well to us. He says, by the mercies of God and all the things that he's done for us, all the promises, all the gifts, all the power that he's given to us and the victory he's promised to us in view of all those mercies that we didn't deserve in the first place, he says, "I urge you to live your lives as living sacrifices for him. That means we lay our lives down. We say, God, you are so great, you are so grand, I put my trust in you, and I lay my life down. It's not about me, it's only about your glory. And so we live by faith, as those people of old did, for the glory of God, trusting he's got something in the future for us that's greater than we can ask or imagine. And so, we, like these people who say such things, we know that there is a home ahead of us. We know there's a country that's better, that we're waiting for, we're looking forward to, and we'll put our faith in that. God has prepared a place for us. But he says this, surrender yourself to me, be baptized into my Son. And he says, for as many of you who are baptized into Christ, you are clothed then with my Son. So when God looks at us, and we are just as imperfect as all those people who have gone before, we're all flawed. If you've been here for a while, you know that full well. If you're just visiting with us, let me break the news to you. We're all broken. But he says, here's what I do. For as many of you who are baptized into my Son, you are clothed with my Son. You are purified. Because here's what God does. When he looks at us, he gets to see our clothes. And when we're clothed with his Son, guess what he gets to see? He looks at you and he says, my goodness, you look just like my child. Pure and blameless before me and dearly loved. And so he says, come, die to yourself and live for me. Be baptized into Jesus, clothed with Jesus, purified with Jesus, and securers of the hope that he's given to us. So we ask today, if you're ready to make that decision, we're ready to help you do that. To put yourself into Christ, to be baptized into him. And we're going to sing this song, God, thank you for all that you've done for us. And while we sing that song, you can come down here and have a seat and say, I'm ready to do that. We'll help you today to do that. If there are things in your life you need to pray about, standing in the back here are the elders of this congregation who are ready to sit down with you in prayer and go to God and be seeking the wisdom and the strength and the power that only he can give. So if you need that help while we sing this song, go back and meet with them and say, can we pray? And they'll say, by all means. Let's do that while we stand and sing this song.